يعني انت تخيل انت بيرك في بيتك ما تحس ان البناية كلها عقب من اول للسادس.
لكن المشكلة ما عليك، المشكلة على البنان.
يعني ما في محل تبعتهم علي.
هنا هو خرجي ضاين أكثر شيء.
كله ضاين والله.
فكرنا ما يلي نحن والشباب، سوينا بركة إنه مش أزل هون وهيين حاصرنا إنه في عنا سبب.
هذا ظلم ياكل. ظلم ياكل.
خايف علي دائما، يعني ما عرفت طاقة الشباب، بس عندي اخوي احمد يعني كان مغير.
يموتوا قدام عيوني قلبي برتاح وبطمن، لاني اذا هن اللي بعاد عني واذا وحده منهم صلى شيء راح ابكي دم بصراحه. يعني
Buonasera. Allora, anzitutto mi presento perché sul programma forse avrete letto che questo incontro doveva essere organizzato assieme al collega Amedeo Ricucci, che mi ha chiesto gentilmente di sostituirlo perché Amedeo è impegnato in Iraq, è stato a Mosul e quindi non poteva essere qui oggi. Però per me è un grandissimo piacere condividere quest'ora assieme a voi e soprattutto assieme al nostro protagonista, assieme a Firas Fayyad, perché per me parlare di Siria è sempre molto emozionante e avete sicuramente già provato una forte emozione guardando le immagini. Firas, probably yes, otherwise I don't think that yeah, at least you can have the translation. Ok, aspetto che Firas mi faccia cenno che riceve la traduzione di quello che sto dicendo, in modo che così possiamo continuare. Sì.
Yeah, yeah.
Allora, quello che avete visto è il promo del documentario, del film documentario che Firas Fayyad ha realizzato e che gli è valso anche un premio molto importante, il premio della giuria al Sundance Festival, e racconta la storia degli ultimi uomini ad Aleppo, Last Man in Aleppo, questo è il titolo. Chi sono questi ultimi uomini? Sono i White Helmet, i caschi bianchi, sicuramente ne avrete sentito parlare in questi ultimi mesi, ne avrete sentito parlare perché purtroppo hanno fatto irruzione nei nostri notiziari. Non soltanto per quello che racconta nel suo film Firas, ma anche per quello che sta accadendo in questi giorni. Non possiamo cominciare questo incontro dedicato al lavoro di Firas senza ricordare quello che purtroppo è accaduto 2 giorni fa nella provincia di Idlib, dove i primi ad intervenire proprio in aiuto delle vittime di questo bombardamento con chiaramente delle armi chimiche, con elementi chimici, sono stati proprio gli elmetti bianchi. Gli elmetti bianchi sono stati i primi soccorritori che hanno permesso a chi si è salvato di raggiungere un ospedale. Purtroppo hanno anche portato via tanti cadaveri, hanno portato via delle persone anche che poi arrivate in ospedale non ce l'hanno fatta. Questo per dire che la Siria, come dire, è un qualcosa che ormai affolla le nostre giornate, soprattutto per noi che la seguiamo, noi come giornalisti. Però il lavoro di Firas si è concentrato in particolare su Aleppo, e lui ha voluto raccontare i bombardamenti, il lavoro degli elmetti bianchi, di due in particolare, Karim e Mahmoud, due elmetti bianchi, della loro vita quotidiana. Ha scelto anche proprio di raccontare quello che era la vita ad Aleppo in quei momenti difficili. Io, ecco, la prima domanda che vorrei fare a Firas è proprio: qual è il periodo della guerra, della battaglia più cruenta di Aleppo che tu hai voluto raccogliere con questo documentario, con i documenti video che poi hanno composto questo tuo documentario?
Yeah. Thank you for having me here, and it's a good chance for showing about from the truth. And I would love like to show the movie, but we still like in the showing the film in other festivals. So the film start in I start like shooting this movie in 2013, and this movie start like on the idea when I've been in the prison, and I was like witnesses on the torture for the humanitarian worker. I was being in the prison because I do a movie about the freedom of speech, and I was like feel in the anger and feel in my responsibility as a filmmaker and as an artist that I have to tell this is a story, and I have to show the people why this is people like the detonation, what behind of this is the revolution, and which is turned to be like a civil war and then international war. And then I met White Helmet in 2013, which is, they are a group from the people who is like collect each other to respond on the heavy bomb from Assad regime, which is used like the barrel bomb, 250,000 TNT or 500 TNT. And this is people, they just was their aim to their neighborhood, and their neighbor and their families. And then with after like couple of months, they start like to collect themselves and to be like more professional in their works. And then they know in for the international community as a White Helmet, but in the for the Syrian they call the civil defense. And one of the main things that it's I couldn't forget it. It's when the bomb fall down like couple of meters, and this is people not run, and just go through the place of the bombing. Even they could be killed by the double attack, which is like start to knowing that from the Syrian regime was bombing the place two time or third time, because he know that the rescue people they will run and to save
per avere ancora più vittime.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. And in 2015, after like shooting from 2013 to 2015, I decide like to make to start using the footage that we shoot from 2015 till 2016, because the Russian start enter and bump Syria. They using different weapon, and they bump the like up to 20 times in the area, and the civilians, all the civilians, and the most of the victim, which is recorded from different organization, that was children, and I was want to show. this is inner conflict inside the white helmets, the volunteer in the white helmet, as a human being believes in the human being values, which is between they leaving their city or they take responsibility about protect their civilians, their citizen and their neighbor, their friends.
Ecco, Firas, perché questa scelta di concentrarsi proprio su dei personaggi, non raccontare soltanto la loro attività come volontari, come caschi bianchi, ma anche raccontare in qualche modo la loro vita, la loro quotidianità, la paura, non soltanto il coraggio nell'intervenire, ma anche la paura, perché poi questi protagonisti dovevano pensare anche alla loro famiglia, anche la scelta di non andare via, ecco, la scelta di rimanere, di non portare la propria famiglia in salvo. Che cosa hai voluto anche raccontare dal punto di vista proprio umano dei protagonisti di questo tuo documentario?
Actually, many when we saw like the Syrian subject, we saw it like refugees, ISIS, terrorism, international conflict. Nobody look what this is people suffering, why this is people leave, why this is people turning to be refugees, leave their country and turning to be refugees. Why there is a terrorism in Syria? Nobody be close and watching the real story of this is people, what the kind of the inner conflict that happened inside in every Syrian, what the kind of the choices that in front of them then that forced them to leave this is country. And was one of this is desire, it was the anger from the media, how they treat the Syrian subject and how they look to the Syrian as a numbers. And I decide like to show this is inner conflict inside Mahmoud and Khalid, the both of character. They have a name, they have a dream, they have a life. They are a people. They do all the best for protect the civilians in there. And those people, this is two characters that I follow them. They all the time they prefer. To protect the civilian on their families. Mahmoud, he has a brother, younger from him, who is volunteer also from the White Helmet. It was all the time he have the scary about his brother, but all the time also he have the responsibility to save the children. It was like, and Khalid, who has two daughters, and he have a responsibility also for his family and for the civilians. And this is inner conflict show us what the kind of the war, what the kind of the result of the war on the Syrian, what the kind of the destruction, not just the building, not just the street, not just the resources, it's destroyed from inside. It's destroyed a completely community when the news said like Assad won in Aleppo. But one on who? On the civilians who destroyed a country, who destroyed the inner life of this is people, who divided community, who leave a completely a million of refugees between Lebanon and Jordan and Europe, and was like this is apart from. Telling this is a story, it's like showing this is face of this is people, the braveness and the iconic of the hope, what the kind of the life they do. White Helmet is just like a basic for attract the young people from 18 to 30 to join White Helmets and not join ISIS, not join Jabhat al-Nusra, not join Al-Qaeda, not join other armed group. They just like attract them to leave. This is young people. They leave their weapons and join White Helmet and finding meaning for their life and finding something to do for their countries. And this is one of the reasons. Yeah.
Abbiamo altre due clip. Allora io approfitterei, comincerei a vedere una delle due clip, la clip numero uno, così vediamo anche altri estratti di questo documentario. Possiamo partire con la prima clip.
المدرسة.
مدرسة. هاي
I'm gonna translate what
sì,
what they said.
Esatto. Yeah. No, volevo sì, speravamo ci fossero i sottotitoli, lo ricordiamo perché è tutto non tutto quanto il film yeah. documentario ovviamente è sottotitolato in inglese. Però ecco, purtroppo yeah. queste due clip, allora adesso Firas magari ci racconta lo scambio yeah. il colloquio tra Cale e dei suoi bambini.
Yeah. Yeah, that this is two children of Khalid, one called Betul and the other called Isra. So the two children, they was like he said, Khalid said for the two daughters, are you going to the school? And then the two children, they said yes, we going to the school, and I'm in the first class, and in the class of the Miss Fatima. And then one of this girl like find in the clip one of what the rescue mission for her father, and then she said, "You, this is you," and he said, "How you find this is clip?" And then they watch the two daughter was brought about their father. This is my daddy, and he, with his friends in they get this is baby. Yes, you get this is baby. So they was like brought about their father, and then we saw like the aircraft that when Khalid going like he going like to find the medicine for his daughters, and then the aircraft like flying in the sky above.
Perché questa è stata la vita quotidiana ad Aleppo Est, quella di Khalid e dell'altro protagonista, cioè una quotidianità fatta anche di bambini che cercano di andare a scuola, di vivere una normalità che insomma purtroppo non è stata tale, e quindi questa è stata proprio la scelta di Firas. È interessante anche capire come Firas ha raccolto questo materiale, perché come potete immaginare fino a quando tutta l'Aleppo Est era sotto assedio non era così facile andare e girare, eccetera. Ecco, molto di questo materiale mi stava raccontando, ecco, molto di questo materiale sei riuscito ad ottenerlo grazie al lavoro di persone che giravano quotidianamente quanto accadeva, e quindi anche l'intervento dei White Helmet. Ecco, quindi come ha funzionato la confezione di questo documentario?
Yeah, first what you saw, like it was like shooting for this documentary. It's not like not a footage shoot in different period times and for nothing, but it shoot for this documentary. And we was the aim of this scene was like we want to show there is no medicine in Aleppo. There is not normal life, but this is people they struggle to make this is normal life. And we shot around 300 hours in following this is two characters, Khalid and Mahmoud, and their friends. And the decision was like how we can follow the fear and the conflict, the inner conflict about leaving or staying in their city, and how they want to protect their city, and how they forced to leave their city, and how they end their life in there. And their decision about running to the place of the destruction, their decision about being with their families. During the films, we saw like days, like or months, they far from their family. They couldn't back to visit their family in the house. They couldn't find the medicine for his daughter. They couldn't find the food. They couldn't find that. And it was like, this is a part about how everything around this is to character forced them to leave, but they struggle and they use all their choices to stay. They want to stay. Nobody want to leave his city. Nobody want to leave his home. Even they don't have a food. Even they don't have medicine. But their life unfortunately end in more tragedy and keep this tragedy up and up. Just imagination, like around your house 20 times bombed with a heavy and different kind of the weapons. And with limited choices, no medicine, no food, no classes, no school, no place of no playing for the children, and all of this is obstacle in front of this character's part from showing how this is people like Khalid as a character. He was like searching about the meaning of the life. He trying to create this life apart from his character, ignoring all the badness and blackness around him. And he like one of the time he decided like to go to play football when they told him our city is sieged and two center for the white helmets is bombed and our three of our colleagues is killed, and he said I'm gonna go to play football.
Ecco, sono passati più di 6 anni dall'inizio del conflitto. È interessante quello che diceva Firas, cioè lui si è voluto concentrare su dei personaggi anche per raccontare come queste persone sono cambiate nel corso di questi anni. Ecco, secondo te Firas, come sono cambiati i siriani nel corso di questi 6 anni ormai e oltre di conflitto? Come siriano tu puoi, più di chiunque altro lo puoi dire.
Yeah. This is a story, it's not just about the Syrian, of course. I mean, this is like one of my desire to make this story about understand and trying to understand who we are as a human being. If we put a human being inside the madness war, what the decision could take? He will go to the good side or the bad side. He will decide like to go like to the ISIS or decide to go to the white helmets. And this is two choices and easy choices. If he go like to the ISIS, he will get a lot of money, power, and authority and everything what he want. But if he go like to the white helmet, he will attack vocally from Russian propaganda, and he will attack from left wings. In around the world, he will attack from ISIS and Al Qaeda. They will send a car bomb to destruction. He will kill. He will lose his children. Then the choices in front of this is human, in the mid of the madness is Lee's, but he decided to go to this side, the side of the good, the goodness, and then it's like. This is a desire for understand. It show me like it's how we are when we be in the madness. Who we are when we saw that all the badness around us, and when we saw this movie, when we saw this character, we feel proud. We feel proud about the goodness inside us. It's like kind of social experimental for our lives when we see like when we put into madness decision in the mid of madness war, and we take the goodness, and you feel like we are safe. We are safe as a human. We can do it. We can be good. We create as a good people, not we create as a bad people. And the white helmet is example for iconic of the hope, iconic for the goodness.
Quindi in qualche modo una tragedia come la guerra siriana, una tragedia come quella che si è consumata per più di 4 anni ad Aleppo, ha tirato fuori qualcosa di forte, di potente, di buono anche in molti siriani. È un po' questo il messaggio anche che tu vuoi mandare attraverso questo documentario.
Yeah, I start with this idea. The war is bring the everything bad, but also it bring the best and the goodness in our human being values. It show us how we can protect our human being values, and it show us how we can protect ourselves and be human being and mentally healthy. And it's moral for our moral side. And but just this is people, and the Syrian, they need solidarity and the decision about stand for next to them. And because who kill the criminal is clear. It's not need a lot of light to show him, and not need a lot of evidence to show the criminal. And the good is also clear. Not need a lot of time to stand next to him. When Hitler and when the Nazism and fascism happened, the media and the decision of the people stand next to the people who was like suffering from the fascism and from Nazism. And now in Syria it's the same. It's not need a lot of light to show the goodness and badness. It's clear, it's very clear. And there is a thousand of evidence, especially I have in my films, I have my film, every frame there is evidence about the criminal. With the fact, with the truth, with a fact checked in the ground of Syria.
Vediamo la seconda clip e poi andiamo avanti anche perché per raccontare anche un po' la storia personale di Firas, che ovviamente come potete immaginare è una storia molto particolare. Vediamo la seconda clip. Ecco, qui forse è necessaria la traduzione di Firas, perché altrimenti voi avete visto questi pesci rossi, invece, insomma, può sembrare un'immagine così fine a se stessa, invece il dialogo che c'è tra Khaled e il venditore pesci rossi è molto importante per quella che è stata la realtà di Aleppo durante i mesi terribili, gli anni terribili dell'assedio. Firas.
Yeah, actually I will tell the story behind this scene. One of the day that my cinematographer, my director of photography, sent me the message. He told me like the city of Aleppo was completely sieged. He said to me like, Khaled is crazy. He going like to buy a fish. What we gonna do? It's important. I said, this is our story. Hear our story. And this guy like when he feel like the city will fall down, when he feel like everything, the destruction around him and the death is very clear, is very close, and take a decision to go to buy a fish, and ask like this, the cinematographer to follow him and the recording everything, and how he's react to the fish and what he will do with the fish, and it show us, reflect us, the character of this guy who is like ignore the badness around him. He just like decide like to go to be buy a goldfish because he want to stay. He's a fish in this city. He couldn't leave his city, and he want to stay for the last breath in his city. And he said like for the fish, the sell the fish, and he said like how much cost this is fish and which fish best from the other. He said all is good, all the fish is good, all fish is equal in this, it was like this is a normal fish. It's like show us about the idea of how also the salesman look to the fish. It's like in the justice idea. And I use this is conversation to show who's Khalid and what this is people, who this is people they are. They go to buy fish, they go to play football, they go like to do their daily life. Of course they go like to save the children, but they are not machine. They are not just machine to save the children. They are, have their desire, they have their love for the life, they have something inside them. And Khalid, he buy the fish and he start like to build like aquarium for the fish in his backyard in the center. And he spend a lot of time like with his friend, with his colleague, like to just look to the fish and spend the time with the fish. And the story of the fish is reflect how much these people struggle to stay, how much they use all their choices that to stay in their city, even that this is very close, more than their classes to them.
Ecco, questa è una cosa molto particolare della Siria, perché ovviamente qui in Italia quando si parla di Siria, ecco, se ne parla quando arrivano quelle notizie tragiche come quella dell'altro ieri, del bombardamento vicino Idlib. Arrivano questi cazzotti nello stomaco con quelle immagini di quei bambini con quest'aria quasi sorpresa, bambini che sembrano così come morti mentre avevano proprio un'espressione di incredulità per quello che stava accadendo loro. Però la Siria è stata e continua ad essere anche questa normalità, che certo questa normalità ormai ad Aleppo non c'è più, nel senso che sappiamo che tantissime, tutte le persone che erano rimaste ad Aleppo Est hanno lasciato Aleppo Est. Però se si va adesso ad Aleppo c'è una nuova normalità di persone che stanno cercando di ricominciare a vivere in mezzo alle macerie. Lo dico senza prendere posizione, senza parlare di persone che sono a favore del governo o contro il regime. Parliamo di siriani, parliamo di civili, parliamo di persone che o per scelta o perché non hanno potuto lasciare la propria città, adesso stanno cercando di ritrovare una loro normalità. Una normalità che c'era anche nei momenti terribili. Ecco, questa era una caratteristica che c'era anche ad Aleppo Ovest, dove io sono potuta andare. Ecco, questo continuo stare con il naso all'insù nel momento in cui si vedeva o si sentiva l'arrivo di un elicottero o il passaggio di qualche cacciabombardiere, perché non si sa mai che cosa, non si sapeva che cosa poteva arrivare da su. Però è importante che Firas, al di là appunto di questo racconto che ha fatto di questi uomini coraggiosissimi, tanti di loro hanno perso la vita, tantissimi di loro hanno perso la vita mentre cercavano di salvarne altre. Anche Firas ha una sua storia. Firas nasce appunto come documentarista, come regista, e per delle storie che lui ha voluto raccontare nel 2011 per due volte è finito nelle carceri di Bashar al-Assad. Ecco, credo che sia importante anche questo suo racconto, e quindi vorrei che Firas vi dica che cosa sono stati soprattutto i mesi del suo secondo arresto, che poi lo hanno inevitabilmente forzato a lasciare la Siria. Firas.
I start like working on a movie in 2008 about the freedom of speech in Syria, and I was following a poem writers and who is forced to leave Syria in the 70s to Czech Republic. And in 2011, the revolution started in Syria. And then, in the mid of shooting the movie, I arrested the first time, and released after 3 months. I was like tortured from the secret police, because they need to know why I'm doing this movie. And I was in the mid of this detention center, which is like underground, like. Three floor minus, and there is a children, there is a activists, and there is like a journalist, writer, caricature, painter, and most of them they torture because their voices, because they use their voices to tell what's happened there. And then I released after 3 months, and then I arrested again, because after that, the desire be more stronger inside me. I want to tell this story. I want what I saw, what's happened in my body. What already I know, this is like from the 70s in Syria. But when you that's happened in your body, and when you saw this is the criminal that happened in the detention center, you feel in the responsibility that. All your work and the tools between your hand as a filmmaker, then you have to do something. It's not just a desire to make a movie. It's more about responsibility. And then I continue to make this movie about this is a writer, and then I arrested again for 8 months. And in the second time, I saw like the criminal more higher, and the way of the torture. And the torture till death for the children, for the humanitarian worker, for doctors, volunteers, and activists, journalists, and artists. It was horrible. And the bodies in the corridors and in the toilets, and you couldn't do anything. You just like saw in your eyes. The fear. Very high in your eyes, but you couldn't do anything. And then the idea of the last man in Aleppo started from there. I want to show the real life of these people who is like in the detention center, or they killed under torture, or they why these people they decide to be in the opposition side also. Why these people they don't agree about Assad? It's opinion. It's a political opinion, and this is not bad to have a political opinion. Everyone here have a political opinion for anything, and if the authority not respect that, where the freedom of speech? Where the freedom of expression? This is what we fight for it for a long time from the beginning of the history. We fight for create the freedom. We fight to make the media observe the authority and push the authority to work for the people, not to be like a king. We change the kingdom to make more the people to choose and to vote. And then we in the crime that happened in Syria, we just leave the killer kill the people, and nobody want to watch. Just like more stories about refugees, more stories about ISIS, no stories about the real life of the people. And it was like by myself. Mm-hmm. By myself, I saw that, and what's happened for me, like they take my nails, and they use the electricity on my body, and they put me like for 12 hours, like every day, in the cold, I get out from the prison without anything, even without classes.
Visto che siamo al festival del giornalismo, in che cosa secondo te la stampa internazionale ha fallito nel raccontare e sta continuando a fallire nel raccontare il conflitto siriano? Premesso che è un conflitto molto difficile da coprire, perché ci sono zone del paese dove è praticamente impossibile arrivare. Ecco, qual è il più grande fallimento in questi 6 anni nel racconto del conflitto siriano, secondo te?
When the people, when the journalist or the filmmaker, they want to like to make stories about Syria, they have to think about the stories of the people, and not take the decision of saying we don't know who killed each other, and think about what's happened in Syria as two parties kill each other. It's more about to be closer from the people, to make the sound of the people, to get the sound of the people to listen. This is the role of the journalism and the films and the role of the media. I don't think the conflict in Syria is complicated. It's complicated because we don't want to know. It's complicated because it's hard to be close from the people, and it's hard to us like to decide. It's meaning us. Let's make this is the what's happened in Syria. It's happened in Italy. You will stand next to the people or next to the authority. You will say the Russian bombed the tourist in Italy, or you will say that the Russian bombed the civilians in Italy. Let's say it's happened in Germany. Let's say it happened in anywhere. Let's take it as a serious. It's meaning for us. It's touch us. It's I don't think the media, the role of the media to be just observer and say we will tell like objective the story. Because even when they try to take the role of the telling of the objective story, they don't tell the objective. Because if we go like to the two themes, the fact and the truth, there is no fact, there is fake, and there is no truth. There is against the truth. Because you just tell without seeing in your eyes, you take the footage and you use it as you want, as you feel, and your feeling that direct you to say this is the truth, which is maybe not the truth, because the lack of the information trying to put the subject of the people behind and thinking about more about this is big things idea, that to think this is the more interesting from the life of the people and from make the people listen to the sound of the people, it will make the things more harder. It's make Assad to speak for every media and dictatorship to be more public from any normal people who should be in the place to give his sound, to listen for the people, to get the solidarity and to fight for the justice. What the aim of the media? What the aim, our aim in the life? It's our aim like to tell objective story and make the people more confused and not said, oh, we can't do anything. Mm-hmm. What's happened there, it's the both of them, they involved and they should solve their problem. Then where were the rules of the media? They make the confused more and the chaos more, and will nothing solve. It's the same, the story of the authority, and the authority will be very happy. The left wing will be very happy. We said, okay, this is what we need from the media, and this is what the media rules. And the Trump will be more happy also, like, because he said, this is the right news, this is not the fake news.
Purtroppo quello che ci diciamo noi che seguiamo il conflitto siriano è un conflitto che non è in mano ai siriani da tantissimo tempo, è un conflitto che è stato deciso da fuori e continua a esserlo sempre di più. Un'ultima domanda, perché poi volevo dare l'opportunità anche alle persone che sono qui in sala, magari ecco, molti avranno qualche curiosità, domanda a rivolgerti. Ecco, tu hai dovuto lasciare il tuo paese. Ci sono 5 milioni di profughi siriani nei paesi vicini, nei paesi confinanti, 11 milioni di sfollati, ma mi rivolgo soprattutto a chi ha dovuto lasciare la Siria come te. Immaginando che il conflitto finisca domani, tu torneresti subito nel tuo paese e farebbero così anche gli altri siriani?
Actually, this is my next subject as a movie. Is if there is a justice, of course, I will back to Syria. And if there is no justice, I will not back to Syria, because I not linked with the country, there is no justice and there is no freedom of speech. It's not meaning me, it's not my country. It's a country of the authority. It's like now Syria, it's called in the mid of the Arab country, in the mid of in as a Syria, Assad Syria, it's not called Syria. When Syria be Syria, Syria for the citizen, Syria, if there is a freedom of choice, to choice and vote, then I will be ready for the country. But in the fact, there is a climate change in Syria, environment destruction, and water. The water is not help. The water is there. The a lot of chemical effect around in the soil and in the ears, and the country is not ready to receive the people. When we will send the people, there is destroyed. There is no houses. There is no normal life. Syria's need at least 100 years to rebuild. And before building the building, and it's need to build the inner
soul.
The souls and the life of the people again, the belief of the people in there is a justice around them. And when they saw like all these people who killed the Syrian to the court, then they will be a country ready to receive the Syrian again. They will feel there is a justice around them. Yeah.
Bene, io credo che sia arrivato il momento di dare spazio anche a voi, se abbiamo 10-15 minuti, quindi approfittate. Riprenderei due o tre domande per Firas alla volta, in modo che così lui può anche soddisfare le vostre curiosità. Prego. Non c'è nessuno. Non vedo mani che si alzano. Siete abbastanza soddisfatti da quanto vi ha raccontato? Vi lascio altri 30 secondi, se no continuiamo, andiamo avanti. Ah, ecco, finalmente, vedo un dito timido qui in seconda fila, prego. Se puoi dire anche il tuo nome, così. Grazie.
Sì, sono Pietro e... Should I say, ask in English or...
Puoi dirlo anche in italiano, perché tanto lui ha la traduzione, prego.
No, sì, io volevo chiedere a Firas, intanto ovviamente ringraziarlo per la preziosa testimonianza, e chiedergli com'era la situazione prima del conflitto, cioè la libertà di espressione, appunto tu dicevi prima che stavi girando un film su questo, ecco com'era la situazione per tutti quegli attivisti, registi, giornalisti, quindi c'era una censura e un controllo del regime anche prima dell'escalation poi del conflitto siriano che tutti conosciamo, insomma.
Se c'è un'altra domanda la raccoglierei, se no do. Vedo una mano giù in fondo, un paio di mani. I will take at least two questions so that okay.
Allora, innanzitutto grazie dell'intervento, è stato veramente stimolante. Io vorrei fare una domanda. In che modo possiamo promuovere la verità riguardo al conflitto siriano? Viviamo indubbiamente molta disinformazione dovuta anche dal contesto internazionale che viviamo e quindi c'è molta paura nell'approccio. Io vorrei un consiglio da te in quanto regista e soprattutto in quanto siriano su come noi possiamo promuovere la verità.
Ok, ecco, forse ne prendo una terza e poi diamo spazio a Firas per rispondervi.
Grazie, io avevo una domanda. Io ero relativamente giovane, insomma nel 2001, però ricordo ancora una grossa quantità di... Sì.
Ti alzi perché ti sentiamo, no, la voce, ma non
ricordo un sacco di piazze in tutto il mondo che si riempivano di manifestazioni per la pace, contro la guerra in Afghanistan. Io mi chiedo che cosa è cambiato, perché non viviamo più questi momenti, non ci sono delle manifestazioni, anche pensando al ruolo, a come sono cambiati i media, di chi è la responsabilità. Paradossalmente abbiamo i social network, tutti quanti vediamo quotidianamente, penso due o tre giorni fa, anche video, immagini agghiaccianti che forse 10, 15, 20 anni fa magari non arrivavano così dure, così alla nostra vista, eppure sembra che questa cosa non faccia effetto, anzi sembra che al contrario si sia come formata una sorta di piazza nel web in cui magari basta una condivisione o una faccina triste per manifestare quella che è la nostra condanna, insomma, a quello che succede. Quindi mi chiedo la responsabilità anche e il meccanismo, diciamo, dei media, dell'informazione che ha su questo appiattimento e questa assenza di manifestazioni vere, di presenze di piazza.
Allora, perfetto, allora cominciamo. Quindi, Firas, cominciamo dalla la prima domanda, if there was really freedom before the uprising 2011.
Sorry, I didn't hear it because I was like trying to listen to the translation.
I was asking about the first questions, if it was really freedom during the before everything started in 2011.
No, actually, no. There is no freedom of speech before the demonstration or revolution in Syria. And there is like many political movement and happen in Syria, like the Kurdish movement in 2006, and there is a Damascus Spring in 2008 and 2004. And which is like a movement from a group of activists and politician who was like want to make like they asking like for freedom of speech and more, and all of them arrested and they released in the beginning of the revolution in Syria. And in 2006, and the Kurdish movement in Kamishlo, and also the Assad regime, they send like a different military group to Kamishlo to attack them, and arrested a lot of these activities, and also like they are released in the beginning of the 2011, 2012, and some of them still now like inside Naya prison or other prison in Damascus.
Yeah. And the second question was about this girl. She was asking if what should be done in order to promote the truth. What do you think? What do you suggest in order that the truth can come out?
Actually, I don't have a suggest for how we can promote the truth, because I don't believe like in the idea. It's about should this truth like promote it? It's bring, and we have a social media. We have our voices. We have a small camera, not cost like than more 100 euros or 50 euros to record and make small films, small stories that we believe, and that's make us like tell the reality that we saw. And you need like to communicate with the Syrian to listen to their sounds in Syria, or the Afghan in Afghanistan, or the Somalian in Somalia, and then to bring their stories as a personal stories, and not make yourself as a journalist as a brave and go like and shoot yourself and tell the truth from your perspective. No, that tell the story of the perspective of the people, because they are the only people who they can tell their stories, and they can use their voices in the midst of madness that happen around them. And we can use the powerful of the social media, which is like I believe that they can bring the justice. And we need these stories for if we believe in the justice, if we believe in the liberal justice, then we have to do it.
And then there was the third question. Are you surprised of the fact that there are no more rallies in order to talk about the war? That if you think there is a sort of fatigue on this side, because now we do everything on Facebook, just putting some likes and or I don't likes, and probably social networks has replaced, you know, somehow.
Actually, the fear, the authorities and left wings support the fear in the mind of the people and the eyes of the people, and the most of the people, unfortunately, from my conversation with them, they all the time thinking about the refugees will talk our country, the refugees, they get their problem from their country to our country, the refugees will destroy our country. The fear, they build the fear inside the people, and then they support this fear to the people asking to build the walls and start to the authority use their goals, like to make an agreement about bans or take the voices of the freedom of the free media or the media that established on the freedom of speech to use it as a propaganda for them. Unfortunately, many medias, big media that they establish on the sound of the justice, now it's changed to be like sound of the propaganda, and this is very dangerous for every country, for every person who support the justice and every person who support the freedom of speech. If we didn't understand and feel, and this is dangerous, and every one of us think about, we have to use our voices, which is and not thinking in the story of the authority, and we use this is powerful. And our freedom to keep telling that the truth, then we will lose a lot. We will lose everything.
Ci sono altre domande? Vedo, ecco, una mano lì in fondo e poi una mano qui a metà. Tre. Adesso avete coraggio, bravi.
Sì, salve, buonasera. Io sono stato in Siria nel 2010, poco prima dello scoppio della guerra, da turista. Quindi sono stato a vedere i luoghi più belli di un paese che è meraviglioso. E quando è iniziato tutto questo, quando c'è stata questa escalation, io ho fatto fatica a spiegarmi come sia potuto nascere, come sia potuto svilupparsi questa guerra terribile. Allora, io adesso mi chiedo quanto sia veramente il popolo siriano ad aver voluto questo e quanto siano forti invece gli influssi di altri paesi, quanto sia magari il contagio delle primavere arabe e quanto siano forti gli interessi di paesi come possono essere la Russia, gli Stati Uniti in questa guerra, perché ho fatto veramente fatica a spiegarmi, avendo visto la Siria prima, una situazione del genere, un cambiamento totale come quello che c'è stato.
Grazie, allora c'è un'altra domanda lì in fondo e poi veniamo qui davanti da te. Vedo c'è il microfono, ecco.
Grazie, io mi chiamo Giulio Piscitelli, ho lavorato in Siria come fotografo tra il 2012 e il 2013. Vorrei fare una domanda in merito a come vede lui in questo momento, a partire dal 2013, la mancanza di giornalisti esteri che possano dare un punto di vista, diciamo, distaccato da quello che da quelle che sono le parti in causa, le parti in combattimento, perché mi sto accorgendo, parlando con chi ha detto ai lavori e chi non lo è, che spesso si sta creando una grossa spaccatura su quello che è il supporto di un lato o un altro del conflitto, e invece si perde poi in realtà di vista a volte il problema della distruzione del paese, della distruzione dei civili. E quindi la mia domanda è come tu valuti la quasi totale assenza di giornalisti esteri che possano dare un punto di vista, diciamo, tra virgolette, distaccato e indipendente da quella che è la fazione di Assad o la fazione dei cosiddetti ribelli.
Allora, prendiamo un'ultima domanda qui davanti, se magari, e poi lasciamo rispondere Firas. Io avevo visto una mano alzata, c'era anche un'altra lì? Altre due addirittura, accidenti. Abbiamo poco tempo, quindi insomma, ecco, limitiamoci rapidamente, quindi fate domande rapide così cerchiamo di fare rispondere a tutti. Ecco qui, eccolo, è arrivato.
Allora, io volevo chiedere a Firas se durante la realizzazione del documentario aveva ricevuto qualche tipo di minaccia dal regime e se era stato, diciamo, difficile riuscire a sormontare questa cosa e poi a realizzare il film.
Grazie. Prendiamo allora velocemente anche le altre due.
Sì, buonasera. Allora, 6 anni di conflitto siriano è un periodo molto lungo. Sono stati 6 anni in cui ci sono stati tanti cambiamenti anche all'interno dello stesso fronte di resistenza e opposizione al governo di Assad. L'interventismo russo, la comparsa di Daesh, un nuovo protagonismo militare e politico del Rojava e della popolazione curda. In tutto quanto questo mutamento e cambiamento repentivo dello Stato in Siria, esistono due dati di fatto. Uno, White Helmets si conferma essere un'organizzazione umanitaria. White Helmets agisce e opera prevalentemente nelle zone in opposizione al governo siriano. Ora, considerando la incredibile mutabilità del contesto, come fa l'organizzazione a, diciamo così, interagire ed essere operativa, e qual è effettivamente la reale capacità operativa dei White Helmets all'interno di questo contesto?
Ok, grazie. Allora, veramente un minuto scarso per l'ultima domanda, scusa. Eccola qua.
Allora, io sono una studentessa, sono abbastanza giovane, per cui la mia domanda riguarda le nuove generazioni. Noi abbiamo visto come i caschi bianchi, anche durante il documentario, hanno deciso di rimanere comunque sul territorio per combattere per quello che è la loro patria. Ma secondo te, le nuove generazioni comunque che sono nate in questa terra che non gli ha offerto nulla perché non è potuto... Okay. Non ha potuto offrire nulla comunque ai bambini, ai ragazzi della mia età, riusciranno a lottare comunque in nome della terra e ad aggregarsi in nome di un sentimento patriottico, che però questa patria non esiste.
Perfetto, grazie. Allora ricominciamo. Allora, la prima domanda, Firas, era quel ragazzo che diceva: io faccio fatica, quanto questo conflitto è stato deciso veramente dal popolo siriano e quanto invece adesso viene deciso da altri.
First, it's not a Syrian conflict, it's Syrian revolution as a start, and they started from the people. They want justice, and they didn't ask first to change the president. They asked like for limited choices and the basic choices, like there is some laws they want to change, these laws, but the intelligence and the secret police, or Mukhabarat called, they react of this is in Mukhabarat, and Assad was like very violent. They shot them in the street, and then after this is the beginning, start like to develop, but the people like kept like in civil demonstration in the street like for 8 months, and then turning to be like civil war and then international war. Of course, like then after this is 8 months, then a lot of players start like to play and put the money from different side to make this conflict more deep and more destruction. This is country, yeah. Yeah. Unfortunately, yes, after that, but in the beginning from the voices of the people from long time of fighting for the freedom of speech and freedom of expression, of freedom of choices and democracy.
How do you evaluate the absence since a long time of foreign press in Syria? Because so independent press that is not local. How do you evaluate this?
Yeah, how? Sorry.
The fact that there is no more foreign press.
Yes. Okay. So actually, like this is, it's like political decision, international political decision to close the border in front of the journalist to enter to Syria, because they don't want like the international journalists to go to Syria and cover the war. They saw them, they close the border in front of the people to leave Syria, and they close the border in front of the journalists to go to Syria. And this is political decision. It's not not decision from the journalist and not decision from the local people. The problem is the decision of this government, in which is like was under the table, to say let's close the border in front of them, let's make the fear higher, and say no more journalists for the side of the area that under that outside of the out of control of the Syrian regime.
Quindi tu ritieni che anche la narrazione del conflitto sia parziale? Do you think, I can translate, do you think the narrative of the conflict is not independent somehow now?
Yes, when the conflict developed to be international conflict, now it's used different player and different parties. Now, of course, now it's not mean for the Syrian, it's mean for more this the player, the big player in Syria, which is like they everyone needs something, and pieces from this cake.
Have you been threatened during the shooting?
Of course, any Syrian, not just me, as a filmmaker, of course, I get a lot of threat, and every day I have my mailbox full of threat and different messages and what we should do. I mean, any filmmaker or journalist or artist, when he pushed the button that make the authority angry, then the first thing that they will send him like anonymous or like hidden faces, like to say the you're gonna kill, we will reach you in your place, we know where you are, you and all of this. But the decision that your life is, you decide to be a journalist, you decide to be a filmmaker, you decide to be an artist, you decide to choose to tell this story, not make a music video clip. Mm-hmm. When you do music video clip, you will not get any.
How do the white helmets can go on operating in the areas, especially in Idlib area, I suppose, considering the situation right now?
How
the white helmets can go on operating now?
The white helmets, there was 120 white helmet volunteers in Aleppo. They first to leave, most of them first to leave, all of them first to leave Aleppo. Now they are in countryside of Aleppo and in Idlib, and they working because the bomb is very strong in Idlib and countryside of Aleppo. Some of the white helmets is arrested, and some of them was part from my movies, was my movie witnesses about their direct attack and killed on their lives. And the white helmets continue, and with you all support and with you telling the story of this is brave people and iconic of the hope and iconic of the humanitarian worker, will they will continue. And if they leave the left wings and propaganda tell that this is people is terrorists, then ISIS will be bigger, because the white helmet will destroy it, and all of these people volunteer will don't find any meaning for their life, and then they will leave to Europe, or they will go like to one of these armed group.
Last but not least, what the future for the new generations? Is there a future for the new generation in Syria?
It's hard a question, and actually, I'm not a psychological researcher or social researcher. We can learn from the other wars what the second generation or third generation in Syria and in other countries. But I believe that in the abilities and the powerful of the human being, then they can do something, and at least like who is like saved or from the war in Syria and came to Europe, could they back and rebuild Syria? And we can believe in this is side of the hope. There is two sides from anything that, and they have this small side of the hope. I believe more about this is children who is like now they are in Europe, and they will learn, and if there is real support for them and not built inside their mind racism and hate and ignoring, and put them in look to them as a refugees, not as a citizen or as a active people, then this is people, they come back with human being values, with the values that Europeans believe in it. They come back to build Syria with the real values.
Grazie Firas. Yeah. Thank you, Firas. Grazie a voi. Grazie a tutti voi.